welcome back to Petrol Zone. Today we're going to be testing the BMW R1200RS. Stay tuned, I'll let you know what I think.
It was great at the very start. Hands on each other. Couldn't stand to be far apart. Closer the better. Now we're picking fights and slamming doors. Magnify.
So, first things first, what a lovely machine to look at. Very good looking, the designers have done a great job. This one has got additional stickers on the wheels, which I've added, just to kind of make them stand out a bit. They were black before, but I think this makes them look a lot better. So, let's have a quick walk around it. 1170cc. Parallel twin, the same engine that's in the GS model. They have a different exhaust system on this one. I'm not sure if there's any other differences, but it is a little bit more pokey, I think, than the GS. I rode them back to back, and definitely this felt a bit pokier. Probably something as well to do with a slightly lighter weight. I think it's 236 kilograms. This one, and the GS is 240 something, 250 is it maybe? I think the Adventure's about 260, isn't it? I've taken off the side pannier adapters, the kind of framework for it, which as you can see, mounted, there's one hole and then there's the other one. And it stuck down and it was hideous, and I had no intentions of having the panniers, the side panniers on at all, so they've been removed. And I've also added this little hugger, which is quite good, although it is slightly flimsy. It's not too bad, but it's got a bit of flimsiness in it. It's only held by two bolts. the addition on this one, I've put a Givi or Givi top box. So that's the top box mount. You can get the BMW version. Seat's fairly comfortable. I've got the Givi tank kind of box on it as well, which is good. This one is keyless. So I'll show you now. So if I simply just press the button, that turns ignition on. Lovely startup sequence. Now all I need to do to start it, the key is in my pocket, is literally just press the start button. There we go. Sounds lovely, doesn't it? Nice, deep. And when you rev it, you get like a little sideward motion, a bit like the old kind of V8s, V8 engine cars, which is fantastic. It does sound good. So as you probably already know, this is the Sport SE model, so it's got all the additional features on it. It's got the built-in sat nav. This is the BMW Nav 5 system. Fantastic, definite must have, I think. Gives you loads of extra bits of information. You can have a speed, temperature, etc. Look at that. You can pretty much program it to have everything you want on it. It's a really quick way of getting to the information. And also, if you've got the main display on a different setting, which you can change, can't remember how easy it is to do that. Let's have a look. I think you see, I'm getting 56 mpg at the moment out of this, just pootling to work and back. That's fantastic, isn't it? Just notice the heated grips on, and I've not got the engine running, so let's turn them off. So another thing to mention is it comes standard with heated grips buttons here, and you've got two options. I've pressed the button and it'll come up on the display. Look, that's the highest option. Once more is the lowest option, and then off again. It's got automatic headlights, as you can see by that symbol. And what it does, let me show you. So there's the LED daytime running light on, which is pretty bright, as you can see, and it looks the part, most definitely. So it's got cruise control as standard. It's got the controller for the amazing BMW Nav 5. It's got electronic suspension. And with that, you've got road mode, dynamic mode. And what you can do is, if you press and hold it, you can change the whether you've got sort of two people on board, or press and hold it again, one person, or one person with luggage. So it's pretty good in that respect. I've actually got it set to one person with luggage normally, because I tend to have the top box on with a bag in and things like that. You've got various riding modes. So I press the mode button on the right hand side. That is a bit more awkward to press while you're riding along. And also, once you've engaged the road, the mode you want, so say let's have dynamic, say you've got a little bit of power on the throttle, you have to release the throttle before it will engage that new mode. The difference in the modes is simply that it'll sharpen the throttle response up, or weaken it if you're in the, say, rain mode, and it adjusts the stability control and traction control to give you a little bit more sort of freedom of movement. In the rain setting, it'll reduce the traction control, the throttle response, and it'll increase the traction control, so, and the ABS slip, so it'll kind of kick in a bit earlier. Now, if you're having a bit of a spirited ride, you don't want that, so that's why they've done it. They've also put a user mode in there. User, there we go. So you can go into the menus and configure exactly what you want. I've got it set up to the engine being dynamic and the suspension being on the road setting. So that's pretty good. As you notice, it's got a warning light up at the moment for light bulb. And the reason for this is I've added LED side lights and it doesn't like it. So I might have to take those out again, or try and work out a way of adding a resistor in or something, so that the system realises that that it's okay, and it's not to keep flagging this warning up. So let me show you the different menus. You've got a tyre pressure monitor as well, which is really good. I can bring them up on here too. It's not that the engine needs to be on, and you need to have had a few revolutions of the wheel before that will actually kick in. So it doesn't actually report the tyres, just sat here stationary. But it's a pretty useful addition. That is, it saves you having to check your tyres every sort of ride. You can just have a glance down at what it says. The low symbol on there suggesting that my just simply because the bike's cold, because I've not started it up apart from briefly just then, telling me the voltage. What I need to get to on here, one of the options is a style, and there it is. If I press and hold that now, it will change to a different mode. This has got now a digital rev counter. However, it doesn't tell me the speed I'm going, so then I've got to rely on the analog speedo. Now, my one complaint is that analog speedo, when you're, say, back here, you know, where your head would be, is too small. The writing's just way too small. It's not very good at all. So I'm not happy with that one. So the other mode is this one. That gives you another sort of more graphical display of the revs, and it gives you the gear indicator, a larger gear indicator there. Again, no speedo, you've got to look at the look at the actual analog speedo, which I'm not a big fan of. So I tend to leave it on the this mode, where I get a nice digital speedo readout and gear indicator. So that's pretty good. Also, this has got, as standard on the SE model, it has the gear assist, so it allows you to go up and down the gears without the clutch. Once you've started off, you can go up and down the gears seamlessly without the clutch, and it will rev match as you're going down the gears. I think it's fantastic. It really is an amazing bit of kit. The only thing is, you can catch it out at sort of slower speeds and lower revs. Sometimes it'll be a little jerky. I hear this is a 2015 model. I do hear that on the later models they've improved this further. They've got rid of that issue. It's a shaft drive, as you can see. So you'd like to think that it's completely maintenance free. It comes with the Brembo brakes as standard. The brakes are fantastic, really good. It's got obviously the twin discs on the front. Really good brakes. I understand that the they are slightly linked as well. So by pressing the front brake, you're actually engaging some of the back, which is good. But by pressing the back brake, I think it is only the back brake. It's got the upside down forks. So on the RS model, they've gone for conventional forks rather than the telelever system that they put on some of the previous bikes. So you do get a little bit of dive and stuff in the braking, but not too much. It's not that bad. Comes with the LED indicators as standard as well. My one complaint is probably the headlights. So on the GS model, they've given us LED headlights, an entire unit. But on this model, they haven't. I've got halogen headlight bulbs in there. The only LED is the strip down the middle, which on the European spec ones is the LED daytime running light, which is brilliant. But the headlights, I'm not impressed. They're not very good at all. So I'd like BMW to address that, perhaps in the next model. The screen is adjustable. I've got it on its lowest setting at the moment. It does make a difference. You just literally lift it here. There we go, that's on the highest setting. There are only the two options. It depends on how tall you are, I think, and what your helmet's like. It helps, but I'd still say there's a bit of turbulence from the top of it at, say, more than 70 mile an hour. But it's not that bad, and in the nice warmer climates, or if you get really nice warm weather, it is good actually to have it down, and then you can let the airflow come sort of into your face and neck, cool you down a little bit actually. And it looks better with the screen down, let's be honest. So, let's take it out on the road and see what we think. Filtering through traffic, not an issue. It's quite wide. That sort of engine that's sticking out beneath you is always in the back of your mind. However, when you look from the back, the wing mirrors stick out roughly the same, if not slightly more. So there you kind of whiskers. And I have actually knocked the wing mirrors a few times on van mirrors, because as you can see, they're pretty high, so sometimes you do clip them. Is actually bad. Can't be helped sometimes. At least they're not attached to the handlebars. They're on the fairing, so when it does happen, it doesn't bother. The screen's actually pretty good for weather protection. keeps most of the wind and rain off you, and the fairing's also fairly good at that too. Handling wise, it's quite a long wheelbase, so it makes it pretty stable. Unfortunately, the weight is one thing you do notice on, say, downhill tight corners where you can feel the bike trying to push away. The suspension helps to hide the weight of the bike. The bike's very comfortable. Nice to get a good position. The handlebar position's good. It's sort of on the edge of sporty, but still fairly comfortable. It's not too lent over. It's just right, I think. It's altogether quite a nice machine. What I would say are my pros and cons then for owning the BMW R1200RS. Pros are definitely the engine, the torque. That low down torque is fantastic. Also, the electronics package on it, I'm really, really impressed with. The standard features such as cruise control, electronic suspension, DSC, ABS, etc. That's really good. The adjustable screen is quite handy and you can do it on the move. It's quite comfortable and it's got a nice sturdy handling. Cons, I would say, the negative sides of it are, while the engine is good, it does lack a bit of top end. So it's got great low down torque, but you've got to, when you want to sort of wring its neck, and it doesn't give you that spine tingling sensation as like a litre sports bike would at the top end, but it's kind of aimed at a different riding style. I think that weight, I'm afraid that has to go against it. It's heavy for manoeuvring around into the garage and things. It is a very good low centre of gravity though, so it helps with low speed riding, but it does affect the handling compared to, you know, the likes of a sportier model. You do notice it. The width of it can be a bit of a problem too. It's always there, it's very wide, and the headlights are pretty poor. They're the downsides. Overall, fairly impressed with it though. Nice machine. Question is, what do I replace it with?
So guys, thanks for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe. See you next time.